guess I can move this right here. So morphine is the compound on the right. And you can see it's got a phenolic group sticking up and a sort of a flat region. And this is fentanyl. And when I, so, actually I went around the wrong way. This one, the one on the right is morphine. So you see its characteristic is to have those two rings sticking up in the air and a flat surface. So what the fentanyl has done is it's got that same shape as the morphine, but it's extended the flat region. And so it's using the shape to get it into the active site. And then it's putting a very hydrophobic flat region on there. And that stops the drug leaving the receptor site. You have more contact. And it's an example of the van der Waal forces that I mentioned earlier. So by making the drug have a longer tail, we've actually increased its potency. So it's selective, because it's going to the target site, it's going to this opioid target site, and it's based on that shape that you see with the part sticking up in the air. But because it's got a longer flat tail, it sticks much more tightly to the receptor and stays there for a longer period of time. So you don't need so much of it, and therefore it's more potent. So that's I think, a good example for that. Okay, let's go back. So now we've shown that we can be selective, we can alter the potency of the drug, we know that metabolism can occur. So a combination of those two is worrying about how long does the drug remain in the system, and that comes under the general title of pharmacokinetics. So we want to know how much of the drug is absorbed in the first place, and then when it got there, how long did it stay there for? So when we look at the concentration in the blood, we'll notice that it will build up to a concentration of maybe minutes or maybe an hour, depending on the route of administration. If you inject into the bloodstream, it's going to go up right to its maximum value very quickly. If you take it orally, it's going to depend on the rate at which material moves down the gastrointestinal tract. So it might take an hour, for instance, to get to where it's going to be absorbed. But after that, then the drug will gradually decline in concentration. And the concept here is, what is the length of time it takes for the drug to go from its maximum dose down to half that maximum dose? So you hope that the drug is effective over a fairly wide range, but you want to know when the drug will actually come down to one half of what it was originally. Okay? So if you were to take orally administered estradiol, you'd find that the half-life in the blood is about 10 minutes. So very, very rapidly. So you go through three or four half-lives, and essentially the drug is gone. So you don't get any effect. So what we can do is chemically modify the drug by putting a group on the estradiol in one of the places where metabolism occurs and block that metabolism. And now the ethinyl estradiol can be taken orally and for it to be effective. So it's used in contraceptive pills. And then we mentioned therapeutic index a few times, so we want to know what is the ratio between the highest non-toxic dose to the lowest effective dose. And you want this to be very wide, because if people are going to take this and you don't have the ability to study them carefully, you don't want to poison people. And so you want drugs to have a very wide therapeutic index. Drugs that have a very narrow therapeutic index have to be studied in hospital and with all the support of measuring the levels that they actually achieve in the blood to make sure that they don't go too high. So some of the blood thinners, for instance, fall in that category. You don't want somebody to have such a high level because of their metabolism that they could get cut and then lead to death. So this will be really important to understand. Okay, so just a little bit about designing drugs. So we talked about how 17 beta estradiol was modified to prevent rapid metabolism. When we're designing an antihistamine, we have to worry about, can we target it to the brain? If we're trying to treat people who get nauseous in traveling. Or could we target it so it doesn't go to the brain, but interacts with receptors that are present in the gastrointestinal tract that normally respond to histamine. So you want to make an antihistamine that has that particular property, right? It's become a huge industry. We've mentioned this a couple of times now, but the attempts to do combinatorial chemistry, in other words, robotic synthesis, really didn't work very well. And high throughput screening doesn't take into account metabolism. So I actually suggested to Dr. Collins that what we need to do is to get the biomedical engineering groups to put together different combinations of cells that you would typically find in the body, and then to test every drug or every candidate you might be thinking that would be a drug in a contrived cell system and do it in a high throughput manner. And this is now something that they are doing. So we'll test toxicity first, because it's terrible to spend hundreds of thousands or millions or even billions of dollars on a compound that turns out to be toxic for humans. It's far better to actually have tested that in the first place and save $1 billion. And so we worry now about personalizing medicine. So you've probably heard of it's actually got a new name. They call it precision medicine. The idea is to get a drug that's optimally ideal for you and the medical condition that you're dealing with. So if you get cancer, you get a particular type of cancer, instead of using a drug that just kills all cells, but particularly kills the ones that are faster than over, these were the anti-cancer agents that were used in the beginning, and a lot of them. But they're very toxic. So somebody who has chemotherapy with these compounds is basically being poisoned. And you hope you will poison the tumor more faster than you're poisoning the person. Now, as we've got a better understanding of how all the metabolic pathways and signaling pathways work, we can find out what is the basis for the tumor growth in that particular person? And then can we get a drug that will hit that particular target? So now this is a very personalized target as opposed to be a drug for everybody. And so that's really where it's all heading. It's actually rather expensive. I'm not sure it's really deliverable. But it could allow stronger drug regimens to be used that will target the tumor and not take out the brain or the liver or other organs. And so there's all sorts of methods for doing this, and that you just the words are here, the name of some of these. And then variety of types of technologies, genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, metabolomics. I'm working on the latter, the microbiome. And these, by understanding all of these things, we can maybe understand the particular problems that the person might have. And the knowledge will explain sometimes why the drug is working somewhere else that we didn't expect. It may explain exactly how the drug is working, and we also perhaps can predict the toxicity. And so there are all sorts of methods. I think you need to be smart about those. The costs. If you were going to do your DNA sequence, a lot of people see adverts for DNA sequence out there every day. You find out really who you are, and then you find out if you're not Jewish, or you're not African, or whatever you might be. And so there are ways to do it. Whole genome sequencing was about $10,000 worth, but it's now recently come down to $3,000, and people are trying to get it down to about $1,000. So we know everything. all the genes that you have. The problem is getting that information, that piece of data is easy. The interpretation of it is much, much more expensive. And so perhaps, you know, somebody has calculated that perhaps for an individual patient with cancer, it takes $1 million to develop a particular approach for that individual patient, which obviously is not going to be an issue, very big. And so that's pharmacology. You're going to learn a lot about the things that I talked about in the coming lectures. And I hope you're a little bit more aware now of what pharmacology is and some of the issues that you have to worry about, particularly in the area of drug-drug interactions. So, thanks.